No quiero vestirme. Me quiero quedar. When you look at the beginning image of this discussion, you might be asking yourself, what does a plate of food have to do with social development? Well, you can't do social development on an empty stomach. It just doesn't work out very well. You lose focus and you can't concentrate if you haven't had a good breakfast. And how are you supposed to advise other people about how they should live their life if you yourself didn't start the day out with a good breakfast, right? This is the national dish of Jamaica. It's called aki with salted cod. Looks like scrambled eggs or some type of an omelet. It looks like scrambled eggs or some kind of omelet, potatoes, but aki is a fruit. And I think you probably know what cod is. Aki is an interesting fruit, though, because you have to be careful how you prepare it. You don't want to eat the seeds because the seeds are toxic. They probably won't kill you, but you might wish you were dead if you were to have one. They make you throw up. In fact, there's a sickness called the Jamaican vomiting sickness. I'm not making that up. That you can get from eating the aki seeds. So you just have to make sure that they've been prepared correctly and then everything's good. In fact, what looks like scrambled eggs here is the fruit. And then somewhere in that is the salted cod. And I try to work food images in. One of the comments I made on a previous video was that if you want to know something about the country economically, is you find out who the largest private employers are. If you want to find out how the country is socially, eat their food. Eat their national dish. Go to a regular restaurant. You don't go to a touristy restaurant. Go to some hole-in-the-wall restaurant and eat their food. Drink what they drink and eat what they eat. And when you do that, then you'll have an appreciation for who the people are. You're probably not going to get that at a resort, though. You're going to have to step outside the comfort zone and eat something that may look or taste or have a consistency or texture that's slightly different than what you might be used to. But I think you're probably used to the tomatoes and the coleslaw that are part of this dish. It's usually served with fried plantains, which is like a banana. In fact, it's part of the banana family. And some other kind of like hard bread or a biscuit or something like that. What are remittances? Why are remittances important? One of the things that's been part of the discussion, one of the topics that's not been part of the immigration discussion in the United States is the impact of remittances abroad. So when people go outside their home country to work, they're doing that because they can't earn enough money in their home country. But they have families back there that need food and clothing and they got to pay bills and stuff like that. Because they can find better jobs that pay them better. Even if it is working in a field in the United States, they're potentially making more money doing that. Well, obviously they're making more money doing that than if they had stayed home. One of the things that you'll notice from this, though, is you're not seeing doctors, lawyers, engineers, chemists, physicists, accountants, computer programmers, database administrators coming across the border looking for work. It's really the bottom portion of the socioeconomic ladder that's trying to work their way across. It's the uneducated. They would have a hard time finding employment in their own country, in Mexico, and further deeper into their own country is what I should say. So they come to a place that's relatively close where the potential is greater for it to earn better income, better wages, because they're essentially unskilled. So the unskilled labor from abroad is competitive or tries to compete with the unskilled labor in the United States. And I don't mean for anybody to take that the wrong way, but there's skilled means you go to school to learn the trade, like when you become a plumber or an electrician or a metal worker, a steel worker. When you learn a skilled trade, then you're a skilled worker. There are other types of occupations in the United States which you don't have to go to school for in order to do. So So that's the difference. And that's where the competition for those jobs increases. So that's why it's important to stay in school so that your employment doesn't become, well, you're still going to find competition, but at least you're going to not be competing with an unskilled wage, because most of the educated jobs or jobs that require education are going to pay you better than an unskilled job for the most part. So remittances. So these unskilled workers, or maybe mildly skilled workers, work abroad and they send part of their paycheck home. That's a remittance. They remit their money back to their families, and their families use it to fill in the income gap that they have that created the situation why usually the male had to leave the house, the father or the husband had to leave the house in order to find employment to fill the income gap that was not being met by having work at home. Overall, remittances can add several billion dollars to a developing economy. If you do some research on this, you'll find that there's potentially about $30 billion that leaves the United States every year that is remittances sent back home by legal immigrants and illegal immigrants. Okay, so when you see workers at a local grocery store at Western Union, that's essentially what they're doing, is they're sending their money back to their families. One of the things that doesn't seem to come up as part of this conversation, I've heard about the money leaving the country. That seems to be an argument that says, well, we're paying them money and then they're sending that money back to their families, or it's leaving the United States. We don't want the money leaving the United States. But one of the things that people need to do is they need to do more of downstream thinking about things. There's not a very much critical thinking going on across the board in our political environment in the United States. Everything is the here, everything is the now, it's very polarized. It's either bad or it's good, or it's evil or it's good. And that's really not the way the real world works, except in very extreme circumstances. So you might say, well, it's bad to kill somebody. Okay, but it's not bad to kill somebody if you're in an act of war, right? So we have had many soldiers killed, and we have killed many people abroad in Afghanistan and Iraq. So obviously, the act of killing someone in and of itself has to be set within the context of the action. So that's essentially what I'm saying, is we have to look at what's going on, because the context makes all the difference. So what I encourage people to do is you've got to set aside your own personal belief system and your own personal biases and your own personal gut feelings and what you think are common sense rules, because a lot of those things that people say are common sense are myths. So the idea of migrants coming to the United States and stealing an American job, while it's not exactly a myth, you're not finding people coming to the United States illegally and competing with doctors, lawyers, chemists, physicists, physicians, database programmers, police officers, you know, nursing, teachers. It's just not happening. They're basically looking at these at unskilled jobs. That's where the competition is. And one of the other things to go back and revisit this point three that people miss is remittances keep people from leaving. Okay, so what do I mean by that? The idea is money is being sent back to their home countries. So this money is keeping that family in place. It's putting food on the table. It's giving them shelter. It's giving them clothing. Maybe paying for school supplies for their kids. It may be paying for school for their children. And maybe helping them save money to send their children abroad so they can go to a school in the United States or in Europe somewhere perhaps, so that they can have an opportunity that the parents didn't have. But my point is the remittances are keeping that family there, because if the remittances weren't coming in, if the father or the husband wasn't sending money back home, then there's a good chance that what would happen is you'd have chain migration. Is eventually the wife would try to sneak across and bring her kids. And now instead of having one illegal immigrant, now we have four illegal immigrants. But because then money is going back to Panama or going back to Honduras or going back to Jamaica or going back to Haiti, those people are staying in place. Now what's happening to the money once it's there? Well, that's another interesting question. Because once the money is there, it's being put to use like it's supposed to. It's putting food on the table, clothes, shelter, those types of things. And there are cases where there is money above and beyond what they need to do those things. And so people are making their own little cottage industries. They're doing basic sewing and textile work, or they may be doing some type of trade craft to support some of the trade shops in the resort communities. And so you have these little cottage industries springing up with the excess revenue that's left over, the excess income that's coming in from the work abroad. And so that sort of helps trickle into the economy a little bit. On the other hand, is that the people are becoming complacent, right? They're not leaving the country because they're now so well off because of remittances. And when I say well off, it doesn't mean like they're out driving around Mercedes or anything like that, but they may have been able to add on a new room to their house. They're able to buy nicer clothes. They're able to spend more money on groceries. And perhaps they're not having to work as much now, right? And so if they're not having to work as much because the husband is working his ass off in the United States, when men return back to their families or their communities and they see people being lazy because they're basically using the money that their spouses are sending back to support themselves, there's also some resentment that's born out of that. And so there's lots of issues that go on. None of these issues, we're in a political climate in 2012 and gearing up for a political debates. And a lot of the talk these days is essentially, in my opinion, nonsense because no side, whether they're Republican or Democrat, really wants to educate the United States in honest and fair ways about economic decisions and economic choices. They would rather pander towards people and use bullet points and use sound bites and pick people's words apart and attack them rather than educate the American population about different economic aspects and different aspects of geography that affects the United States and how we affect the geography of others. And it's really sort of it was once sort of a bad thing and sort of a nuisance, but now it's almost becoming, it's no longer a nuisance. It's negligent on both parties to fall into the abyss of ignorance and backbiting and stuff like that. But I digress. So with remittances are an important source of income for the Caribbean, but it does come with some costs.